In this video, we will discuss the Lorentz factor, also known as the gamma factor, which pops up everywhere in special relativity. Then we examine it and continue the discussion on some interesting equation where this factor is present. More precisely, we will discuss things like length contraction and time dilation, two very mind-boggling concepts of special relativity. Finally, we will take a look at how cosmic muons can reach Earth using special relativity and not using Newtonian mechanics. Of course, we know that they reach Earth because we can measure them, thus the theory of relativity must be correct for this case. Let's start by taking a look at the Lorentz factor itself. It is written as gamma is equal to 1 over the square root of 1 minus v squared divided by c squared, where v is the velocity of the object and c is the speed of light. The name comes from the Dutch physicist Hendrik Lorentz, who was trying to understand electromagnetism and mentioned this formula in 1904. If we take a look at this formula, we notice two important things. Firstly, if the velocity is much smaller than the speed of light, then the Lorentz factor becomes just 1. This is the limit where the world works just like how Newton described it. In this case, the effects of relativity are negligible. Secondly, if the velocity is the speed of light, thus v equal to c, then you get division by 0. This is because massive particles can never move at the speed of light. Only massless particles can travel at the speed of light, and they always travel at the speed of light. One can also note that if the velocity is greater than the speed of light, you get an imaginary number. The physical world is real and not imaginary. Thus, it is not physically possible to travel faster than the speed of light. So if you need a simple example of why traveling faster than the speed of light would ruin the last 100 years of progress in physics, then this is a good example. Now it's time to consider some of the more funky aspects of relativity, namely length contraction and time dilation. One can start by considering the length contraction, L equal to L0 divided by gamma, where L is the perceived length by an observer and L0 is the actual length or the proper length of the object. Thus, if the object we are observing is moving very fast, we will see that the object gets shorter since gamma becomes larger at larger velocities, thus L gets smaller. But notice that L0 doesn't change as the object actually does not change its length from its own perspective. It's only contracted from the point of view of the observer. This leads to the obvious question, what happens to time? The answer is that the opposite happens, and we can express the time dilation as t equals to gamma times t naught, where t is the perceived time by an observer, and t is the actual time or proper time. Here we see that if you move really fast, an observer will see you being older than you really are. Such a concept is rather unintuitive, but nevertheless correct to the best of our knowledge, as the theory of relativity has been studied and tested in great detail. One can combine these two concepts to try to understand why cosmic muons can reach us. First, one can start with explaining the problem. The Earth is constantly bombarded with cosmic rays, and this causes muons to be produced around 15 kilometers up in the atmosphere. Now you may ask, what are muons? And they are simply like an unstable and heavier cousin of the electron. The issue is that the lifetime of the muon is around 2 microseconds. These cosmic muons travel at almost the speed of light. Now we can calculate the approximate length that they will travel using Newtonian physics. The calculation is very simple. You multiply the speed of light with the mean lifetime of 2 microseconds, and this gives you 300 meters. Thus, these muons should decay long before they hit the Earth, but nevertheless, we can observe that about 10% of the muons actually reach the Earth. To resolve this issue, we should replace the lifetime of the muon with the observed lifetime and combine it with the fact that muons travel at 99.98% the speed of light. Thus, the gamma factor can be calculated to be approximately 50. Thus, the observed time is ct, which we can expand as c gamma t naught. And this will actually give us a length of 15 kilometers. Remember that this is the mean lifetime, so some will live longer and some will live shorter. Most importantly, we see that in this relativistic correction, it is indeed possible for a muon to travel 15 kilometers down to Earth, and that's why we can measure them. The word relativistic refers to the fact that the velocity is comparable to the speed of light. So in general, what happened here? From our point of view, the lifetime appears longer than it is due to time dilation. But from the point of view of the muon, the length to the Earth appears shorter than it is due to length contraction. This example clearly shows how time and length really are relative quantities. We have now seen a few examples where the Lorentz factor pops up and gives relativistic corrections as per the theory of special relativity. Before finishing this video, one can also consider a few other quantities subject to relativistic corrections. Mass is, for example, also affected. As velocity increases, the mass of an object also changes as m is equal to m0 gamma, where m0 is the rest mass when the object isn't moving. This also means that Einstein's famous energy equivalence equation changes at relativistic velocities. Thus, E equals mc squared should actually be written as E equal to gamma m0 c squared. And if we have just a rest mass, then the gamma just becomes 1. Of course, other quantities are also affected, like momentum, but the idea should be clear. You just add the Lorentz factor appropriately. Conclusively, this video should make one thing clear. The way we experience the world changes when the velocity becomes close to the speed of light. This leads to some very interesting results, and at the heart of this we find the Lorentz factor, which governs how the world changes at relativistic speeds. You might ask what you would see if you started moving at the relativistic speeds, and the answer is that you will actually begin to see how space-time curves around you, and you will start to see behind you as the space-time curves. In this limit, where you travel at the speed of light, you would see everything around you, even what's behind you. This is very weird. But don't expect to ever be fast enough to actually experience this, because you would need a crazy amount of energy to accelerate a human to this velocity. As always, I hope you liked the video, so please feel free to comment, like, and subscribe, and stay tuned for the next one.